Set that up. We're back live, guys. The last one got cut off because phone died. But yeah, we're still here with So Shameless Podcast. We got Key. We got my main man, Tahoe. It's such a great conversation. Like, you know, I've been on two other podcast interviews this week. And they've been great. But I don't like when people like want to finish a thought before I move it into the next thing. So I appreciate the flow of conversation.
I try to do that, but I cut off people. I do. And I have to fight. I have to work against that. But we don't have a time limit. Maybe it's because they're in studios. So that they
try to
push it. So
yeah, I do feel that's often the case with most podcasts. Yeah, I can hear you.
If you guys ever have a problem, push up the cord.
Right.
So that works. And once we finish the trolls, we will press start the cord.
And now she's put some more shit in my mouth.
I got an oral fixation, so it's time.
He's a happy man.
Yes, he is.
All right.
It was on my bucket list, I said. 2018 goals, to suck more of my magic.
Oh, my goodness.
I wish I'd have got there. I'm pressing record. All right, we took a small break. We'll come right back. All right. So 2018, you just did what? No, I'm sorry, we went away for a second. We had to come back. She had to come. But she said, like, yo, I got an oral fixation. He's like very happy.
I have an oral fixation. You see, I got this little chapstick box.
Yeah, and I was looking at it. It's actually three chapsticks.
Yeah. It's not a game. It's one almost done in here, and the other two are like full. But on my 2018 goals list, like, the very last thing, which there's no order in these things, I said, to suck more of my man's dick.
What's more?
Just doing it more often, you know what I mean? I do
like
it.
Like, without having sex, I just randomly, like, we're watching TV.
Oh, yeah, I mean, I'll do it whenever. Because he's been like, hey, come to the bathroom. All right,
so that's what we thought was going to happen when he went down. We were like,
oh, yeah, I mean,
come on.
We would have, but nah. Like, we working
he
right
definitely
now.
He was going down. I was like, bro, like, we only got a half an hour. And just if you do, my sink is kind of wobbly. All right, get back into it. First of all, shout out to. They're kissing me.
Oh no, she was transferring the chapstick.
Oh, is that what that was? It wasn't actually a kiss. Using kisses.
That was a kiss.
My sex life sucks.
Stop!
I just realized.
I have no intimacy.
My sex life sucks.
What intimacy?
Because I'm not connecting into a place where I'm in front of people and I want to wipe chapstick from my lips to your lips and stuff like that.
Because you're like, what?
What is it?
Yeah, you'll be like, what are you doing? Like, why are you doing it right now?
On your thing, you can just pass it.
Yeah.
All right, so we're here. We're getting back into it. I have two more questions. One is, Naeem spoke about the erotic places, zones, on men versus women. He said that women have their clitoris, and it's the main place, right? It's
the organ strictly devoted to sex.
The organ
pleasure.
Pleasure. And women also have two of those sex centers in their brain, and men only have one.
I want to hear about that. Give me a second. Wait a second. Let me finish this.
I'm just saying that women are more built for sex than we are. But
you would think that is opposite.
Women are more built for sex than
societal
perception.
Fuck society.
Fox society. Yes, I said that earlier.
I'm so tired of society. I don't fit what is cool in society anymore. And I'm like, you know what? I don't care. Just let me be me. I don't even ask to be a part of y'all.
There's a show on Netflix called Black Mirror. It's amazing.
Oh, I heard about it. I heard it's fucked out. Isn't that dude fucking a pig in that show?
In the very first episode.
Why is he fucking a pig? Can you talk about something else?
Go with your question.
Yeah, the question.
And I really will forget. All right. Are you gonna kiss again?
I'm leaning in.
Can you just get it over with? If you're gonna kiss, just do it now.
It is unending, so.
Unending?
No,
never ending. It could just happen. happened.
Let me look and check my notes. All right. I'm sorry. Women.
You had it right.
Over the course of time. Women over the course of time have so said they don't get enough from men sexually. They said we just want to insert and pump and come. We don't pay attention to y'all bodies. We don't pay attention to you guys sexually. And you want more, right? They say they want more foreplay. Me, I think foreplay, kissing, sucking pussy, licking sucking titties, pussy. Done. Mm-hmm.
Done.
There's a reason. No, there's a reason for this. This is where we're going, done. Right? That's me. I feel like, you know, we touch, kiss, we come coming here, kiss, I'm going for the knobs, twist the knobs, right? We start pulling them, we start pulling clothes off. Now, I'm not saying that I am not 2 years old when it comes to sex and knowing what a woman wants as far as foreplay, right? My shaft, I kind of know. I got a feeling of the shaft. I know what I'm doing with that. But everything else, I'm really not. I've been in one really mature relationship, mm-hmm. and even she was sexually repressed. So mm-hmm. she wasn't even able to tell me what she liked. I used to want to know. I used to ask her. She wasn't able to give it to me, right? And so left me still 2 years old, right? So I said, go for the knobs, take pants off, mm-hmm. kiss down, V-shape, I'm in there licking. I wasn't really good at eating pussy. Right. And the next thing I wasn't. I had to learn on a mango.
The cosine of
you're not.
I learned after.
He said he learned after me or whatever.
I had to. Yeah. Somebody showed me on the mango because I used to do this the stick out tongue thing.
Yeah, like oh.
And that under here hurt when you do that under here.
Straight up. All right,
that wasn't the question.
Eating is fun.
Huh?
Pussy eating is fun.
It can be fun if you look at it like a mango seed. You actually have to.
Yeah, like oh my god. Oh, I'm happy you got visual.
Because you pull at the top, too. I don't know. He probably has a hook. He's like, what the fuck are you doing?
Yeah.
Did he look like a fart? His face, he's just looking around like, what is that smell? Like,
and it's all wrong.
He's like, what are you doing? All right. My question was, what is foreplay for women versus what is foreplay for men? What do women do? Because to me, foreplay for men, as far as a woman's concerned, it's sucking dick. That's it. Sucking dick.
Well, first and foreformal, foremost, sucking dick and eating pussy is not foreplay. It's actually sex. It's oral sex.
Right.
So, but the average person believes that that's foreplay because it's something that you do before you penetrate. But again, that's not foreplay. Foreplay are the things that you do to arouse your partner before sex even begins. And foreplay looks very different for a lot of people. But I mean, there are some basic things that the average person implement in order to for it to be considered foreplay. So one thing, like everyone knows, the whole massage thing. You know, women love massages because not only does that give you time to intimately connect with their bodies, you also have the opportunity to arouse other erogenous zones outside of her vagina. Mm-hmm. The nipples, the neck, the lips, the abdomen, underneath her arms, the backs of her thighs, her feet, the entire body has erogenous zones up along the spine,
the small
of your back, yeah, all of that. Like
I'm gonna jerk off soon as this episode.
So
everybody out, get to stepping.
Oh, the booty, you know, the booty is a very major erogenous mm-hmm. zone, and that's usually where the average man's like, I can't take anymore. I mean, it's interesting because he gave me a full body massage when we first spent the night together, and we were both completely naked, and he had so much reserve. No sex happened that night. I was still practicing celibacy.
Oh, okay.
So I really appreciate that. But that's one form of foreplay, massages. Second thing, conversation. Have a little bit of wine and talk about the things that you quite possibly want to experiment with. Even bring in your porn. If you got videos that can serve as visceral examples of what you want done or what you want to try.
I don't like sharing my phone.
Well, okay, that's fine. But that's an option for men who are comfortable.
Different.
Yeah, but because of men who are comfortable with sharing those things, like maybe there is something different that you're into mm-hmm. that you don't even know how to necessarily express verbally. You can literally be like, what do you think of this video? And then discuss that. And just even talking about sex helps to ease the expectations and the nervousness that people feel around that. Add a little bit of wine into that, you know, if you know you're about to go into it. And it also helps release inhibitions, but you don't want to drink too much because mm-hmm. for some women, you can start to lose feeling down there if you drink too much.
I just feel it in my knees. That's how
feeling in your
drunk.
Knees?
When I'm drunk, it goes to my knees.
That is
they get numb. That's
that
how
a
I
sharp
know.
Person thing? I don't know.
Possibly.
Talking about breasts. She's so...
What are you doing? What are you doing with my breasts? Please, make this connection.
You start losing
make
equilibrium.
You know what?
Your knees is like, you know,
titty
I don't
knees,
like,
titty
stay
knees.
Up no more.
Foreplay can also just be sitting, laying with each other, looking into each other's eyes, and eye gazing and really sinking your breath, you know, really becoming in tune with the energy between you and your partner. Also, going behind your partner, whispering, I'm gonna fuck you, you know, or sending sexy text messages like, you like what I got on? Mm-hmm. Well, I'm gonna take it off for you later, or, you know, I'm wearing this for you tonight, or like he does to me. He sends me instructions. I need you to go and get dressed up, put on your collar, put on your crotchless, body stocking, and wait for me. That's fucking foreplay because it's the
right.
anticipation.
Mm-hmm.
Even sending a story written out of what you fantasize you're going to do and then coming in and actually playing that as a play-by-play. There's so many things you can do in foreplay that are creative
mm-hmm.
beyond just
kissing,
licking nipples, sucking pussy, which is not foreplay. Okay.
Right.
Gotta say that
sex.
Again. Right, it's oral sex. It's all about being creative, and it's also about placating to that person's interest, because let me tell you something. This is the best part about it. If you get a woman or man that really doesn't know what they're into, let me tell you something. Everybody has fantasized about something, but the issue is that the average person has never been asked sincerely.
Right.
And never been asked sincerely outside of the act going down. So, one thing that I've been suggesting to my following and my clients and stuff is set up a date where it is primarily about sex talk. And there's no alcohol involved. This is not happening after hours. It's literally like midday, somewhere public, maybe tea, tapas, whatever, but no alcohol, right? And this literally is a date where you specifically talk about sex. And if you need to, bring a notebook with notes you've written down of things you want to discuss, your likes, your dislikes, your fantasies, your past experiences. Encourage your partner to do the same thing. And you come to the table and you talk about it. And talk about it without any expectation of anything going down after it. It's literally just a conversation.
And that's why you say no alcohol.
Yeah, because a lot of times we rely on alcohol or weed. Yeah, try not to get high before that either. Like, be completely sober.
Noted.
Right, yeah, because, you know, somebody was like, well, what about weed? And I was like, good question, because, you know, I smoke weed, I'm a 420-er. But you want to be completely sober, because you don't want to rely on some inebriating substance to get you out of your head.
Right.
You want to truly be able to connect consciously with the person that you're planning on having sex with. And then, two, make your sex purposeful. Why are we even doing this? You know, because... If you're just...
Can you just do it because you want to do
it? I mean,
that's
you can.
That's not a purpose?
That's not a purpose at all. It's just something
it
to do.
It's a purpose because I want
to
have sex. I want to have sex with
you. What do you think of free sex?
I want to
that,
see
do you
come.
Think, is sex just sex or is it transfer
sex
energies?
Is,
do you think
sex
it's more...
is just sex when you're doing it and you're doing it unconsciously. It's like you're on autopilot. It's nothing for your bodies to get aroused from sexual
mm-hmm.
stimuli. And there's nothing for your bodies to connect and insert slot A into slot B, and then you're getting it in. But when you have a purpose for why you're joining, your purpose can be to heal. Your purpose can be to connect more intimately. Okay, bam. So in doing that and having that purpose, now you see that your sex is going somewhere beyond just, we need to bust a nut. And again, that purpose can be established during your date when you're talking about sex. So now, when you actually schedule the time to get it in, you have more direction. The issue with a lot of people is that you're guessing based on the last person you
mm-hmm.
had sex with. And you got the lights off and shit, and you're under the covers, you're fooling around. You don't have a map to that person's sexual pleasure. Because, okay, for most people, the end destination
yeah,
is the orgasm,
mm-hmm.
or at least satisfaction. But how are you going to know how to get there if you don't have a roadmap to that person's pleasure? Because everybody's roadmap is different. You know what I'm saying? Like, my roadmap could be like the roads and the grill in fucking Jamaica where the shit's bumpy and it's going all like this. Meanwhile, the other person, the next person could just have a straight roadmap where it's like, you do this, 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 and I'm there.
Right up the block of motion.
Exactly.
Would you, Key, read this page for us? It's actually a whole chapter.
The whole page? Chapter 18?
It's just a page, yes.
It's just a page. Sex means absolutely nothing. You give sex all the meaning it has to you. Sex is not good or bad, right or wrong, holy or sinful. Sex is neutral. The purpose you give sex is what gives it meaning to you. The questions to ask are you having sex in a state of love or fear? Are you having sex in a state of guilt or innocence? What is the purpose of your sexual joining? What is it for? Since sex involves another person, you must join in a mutual goal. Sex itself may be neutral, but it can be used to hurt or to heal. It can be used to express love or to express fear, and absolutely nothing in between.
Oh.
Yeah. Really? Okay.
How do you express fear with love?
Right.
Oh, let me continue. Wait, what? Anyway. And absolutely nothing in between. That is why rape is sex, but it is hurtful. It is not consensual. Love is always consensual. The program teaches that sex is special, sex is meaningful, sex is holy. Remember, sex is nothing. I'm mind fucked, you're reading. All right. The goal is always...
Sex is some physical shit.
It is. All right. The goal is always love. Love can be expressed in any form, including sex. Fear can also be expressed in any form, including sex. Which is why sex should be used as a means of joining in love. It is not used for joining in love. If it is not used in a joining of...
They're kissing.
I'm sorry.
Eating and kissing.
I can't finish a page without kissing. Okay. Oh, where was I? Okay. Fear can... crazy. This is the most intimate...
That's dope.
Yeah, it is dope. The goal is always love. Love can be expressed in any form, including sex. Fear can be also expressed in any form, including sex, which is why. Stop kissing! Oh, God! All right, hold on. Okay, here we go.
I'm sorry. Okay, those of you who are listening.
They keep kissing, guys. Can she not read?
They keep kissing, girl. And at this point, we've been really mind fucking everybody in here. It's like a mind orgy. Right
it
now.
Is a mind orgy. We're talking about,
bro, don't touch me. I'm up right now.
Like, I'll be around. I'll be around, but I'll touch my man.
Bro, I'm up right now. Just everybody calm down. Let's get the fans going on this motherfucker. Because. You're kissing, man.
Wait.
And Kiana right here, we used to fuck the titties and the hard nipples, and they over here kissing, and they rubbing and talking about sensual and riding this end, because you can't, I don't know what's going on. I'm sweating. What I do see.
I lost the page.
No, what I do notice, though, seriously, what I do notice, when she was talking, and I know you're going to break down that passage, right? But when Taomi was talking about foreplay, and she said, you can send her a text saying, I want you wearing this, and I want you to do this, and when I get there. Mm-hmm. That did something to me.
That shit turns me on when
that
he gives me instructions.
That shit did something to me. Because it's like, that's like, it's, right? Like, that shit did something. I'm the dude. Like, maybe she might do that to me, but to me to say that to her, that means I have... There's something there. Like,
yeah.
We're doing this all day.
And look, I had a partner who I was in a relationship with for like 5 years, and he used to love for me to tell him how it would go down when we would get together. So he helped. Shouts out to him because he helped me develop like my erotic story writing. So I would send him a text message just laying it out, and it would turn him on. And so then whether we acted that out or not. Just me telling him how it could go down, it was a huge turn on for him, and it was foreplay because it got him really excited and anticipating the next time we would see each other. So when he does stuff like that to me, like this was literally a text message last night to me. Put on your collar, put on that crotchless, you know, body stocking, and be waiting for me. I'm going to fuck you tonight.
Yes.
It's hot. And that's a great way of foreplay. Because women like to be given instruction.
Right.
Especially when you buy the stuff you want her to put on or you want to use on her or whatever. You know?
So I'll get the fuck out of here.
You know what he's mean? You know what he's mean? You know it's real.
Girl.
Come on.
Comfortable sexually, all they know how to do is boom, 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 boom. Mm-hmm. They're not into
intimacy,
any type of intimacy, right? Right? Mm-hmm. They just go and say, I don't know why, right? Maybe I'm part of that because I say I am not really with butt play. Maybe I'm just not open enough. Maybe I'm not.
What the man you say? Because guys think their sexuality is like directly attached to their asshole.
I had a follower hit me up, and she said, as a matter of fact, she was talking about it on her Snapchat. Her body is incredible. Incredible. And she was saying how she doesn't come from penetration. She said, woman, I don't know how many of you guys out there that aren't coming. Is it just
over
me?
Over 70%.
Is it like, I'm just not. She said, sex doesn't do anything for me.
Oh.
Why are we doing this? This is what she said. She said, why are we doing this? And it hurts. She said, it hurts. So I hit her and I said, well, maybe the size that you've been going after because you're looking for these big, thick dudes, maybe that's too much for you. And she said, well, they all small. And I said, well, then.
Shallow vagina?
No. I said, then you may be experiencing a thought process that is casual cervix completely closed.
Closed up. Mm-hmm.
And you aren't relaxed enough during any of your sexual encounters. She said that. I don't know if she does or not, but she said maybe I like women, whatever. I don't think that's what it is. I think that she has repressed. Something's going on in her mental that relates back to sex, comfortability, being naked, interacting with the other sex. I think, me personally, now, that's what I wanted to know.
Yeah, I mean, it sounds like that to me, too. I mean, you got to think, too, we are spiritual, energetic beings as well as being physical. Decide to be in these bodies to have this human experience. And the minute a woman says it hurts, there's two things that pop up for me. Either she's not being aroused the way that she needs to be, or there is something within her mental that is causing her to block herself from being open. Because again, the feminine must be open, and that's all I'm speaking now on a physical and mental state. The divine feminine must be open for the divine masculine to penetrate. Mm-hmm. And if mentally you're not open, your body is going to be like, we're shutting down. Mm-hmm. And the vagina is going to perceive any type of penetration as a threat. It's going to dry up, it's going to close up, and push out. It's not going to be receptive of that. Mm-hmm. So there may be something that she has experienced over the course of her life, especially if she has a body that is incredible. Pretty sure she's had that incredible body for a very long time and has been objectified for a very long time.
Made uncomfortable, right.
Yep, and then also when men see incredible bodies, they assume they gotta go harder, do much
trying
more.
Trying to kill it, I said
yep,
that.
Trying
I
to
told
kill
her,
it
I said, well, these dudes trying to kill
it. Yeah, and so, because I've been there. Like, I've had an adult body since I was 9 years old, so I know what that's like. And over time, if you've never talked to anybody about it, if you've never been able to release that stuff and heal from that, it turns into repression, and you basically use those experiences to attack your own body, and now you're at a place where you're like, I don't feel anything. So if she really is experiencing some type of discomfort with this and she wants to get past it, then she should talk to somebody about it.
Can she talk to you?
Yeah, she totally can.
Well, I told her that she needs a sex therapist. I told her that you might need somebody to talk to.
She does. Because I'm pretty sure she's probably never had the opportunity to truly share how she felt about the attention that she gets with her body and the experiences that she's had. Because even me, like, I'm, you know, studying Tantra right now to help with this type of stuff. And in my intake, my teacher, in asking me certain questions, she helped me realize that I have PTSD. You know, I never realized that I had gotten so much unwanted attention and unwanted touches. I've never been, like, touched weird by any males or females in my family, thank God. But just everyone else, even just being like, ooh, let me touch your hair, or hey, girl, what's up? Stuff like that, like just trying to grab you on the street. It's unwanted touches. And your nervous system is always on edge because of that. And then that manifests into other diseases within your body. Mm. So certain things like ovarian cysts, endometriosis, uterine fibroids, PCOS, other types of like ailments that afflict women in our sexual health, those things can manifest because of the energy that we're holding from our nervous system constantly being agitated by this stuff. And then when you talk about women who've been, you know, raped and molested and stuff, it's even deeper. And you're holding all this stuff in your root chakra, which is where your sexual energy sits, and it becomes stagnant. And when that chakra is not spinning correctly, it manifests as dis-ease. So you do have to talk to somebody. And even just talking to somebody helps release that stuff. And it's crazy because when she was talking to me, I was like, damn, I've never talked about this. As much talking and advising as I do for other people, I've never been able to talk just simply about not like being touched in ways that I didn't want to be touched. So I'm pretty sure she's holding on to a lot.
Now, speaking on that, and to take it a little step further, I always find it strange when a woman tells me she's not comfortable masturbating. Or when they say they don't like porn. Like, maybe you don't like porn for whatever. Maybe that's gross to you, you know, for your ideals or whatever. But what do you think? What are your thoughts that a woman wouldn't want to touch herself? Like, what are your thoughts towards that?
That's usually coming from cultural shaming or religious shaming, or, you know, things that she's experienced over the course of her life with the messaging about masturbation. And some women just really don't know how. They don't even know how to approach it. And some women do believe that it's a man's job to pleasure them and to arouse them, so they don't believe that they have the right to do it themselves. So it's really just conditioning.
Well, do you think that for a woman that says that thinks it's a man's job, do you think there's
really
a certain level?
You're really addicted to chapstick.
Girl,
you're addicted.
It's really like a psychosis at this point, because like my mom embarrassed me real bad in like third grade. I had like really chapped lips, and from that point, no, it was fifth grade. And from that point on, it's like chapstick city. Like, that's why I got a whole case.
What do you think? Because you women, y'all get together and y'all start talking about period cycles and all. Just let me stay here. Stay in the moment. Yeah.
Okay.
Regardless, if we put society's judging to the side, we put the church to the side, we put all that to the side, right? Say it's a woman that grew up across the street, her family isn't religious, she don't give a fuck about social media, she's just not into masturbating for whatever reason. Do you think that that comes from uncomfortability, a desire for just men to do it? Is there a connection? Mentally, some sort of psychosis between a woman not wanting to touch her and how much she connects with herself sexually, and then how much she's able to connect with men sexually.
Yeah, I mean, it does really have an effect on how she's able to connect in the moment with herself and with the men she's with, or women, whatever she's into. But it comes from some sort of conditioning. It's not like she's just innately born with the non-desire to not masturbate unless she's asexual. Again, and asexuality is not common. So for the average woman who's out here like, I don't want to touch myself, I don't want to do that, it's something that was conditioned. Something that she grew up hearing or seeing, even if nobody ever said anything to her directly. It could have been conversations she overheard from friends or her parents or her peers, whatever. Because we absorb like our sexual information from like the five P's. It's Professionals, publications, porn. Professionals, publication, porn, peers, and what's the fifth one?
Pastors.
The fifth one is escaping me right now because I came up with these five P's. Yeah. But so when you think you would be a professional, you know, and so
partner.
It might be. It'll come back to me. But so when you think about all the ways that we can absorb sexual information, mm-hmm. it's like, you know, if you overhear your peers like, oh, masturbation, I would never do that. Mm-hmm. Even if she had the thought that she mm-hmm. wanted to try it, now she's hearing her girlfriends or people she perceives as popular or whatever saying they would never do that. And now she's like judging herself. So a lot of times,
subconsciously,
like,
think so anyway.
Yep, subconsciously, you're casting guilt on mm-hmm. the process of masturbation. And so really it just takes for a woman to recognize that this is something that she doesn't want to, she doesn't want to think that way. Because a lot of times we think the thoughts that we're thinking are our own, but they're really not. It's like coming from the ego mm-hmm. and coming from our conditioning. And when you can genuinely say, I don't want to think like this, I truly do want to embrace this, then having that willingness is what's going to attract, you know, the educators or the knowledge for you to learn how to connect with yourself in that way. And that's the first line of therapy that the average sex educator or sex therapist or coach or whatever would recommend to a woman who has never experienced an orgasm. The first question is, can you bring yourself to orgasm? Have you ever tried? And if the answer is no, then you start there. Mm-hmm. Because we have to know our bodies as women. And if you don't, and if you're not connected with your body, there is nothing anyone else can do to bring you to that climax. It starts with self and it starts in your mind.
In my experience having sex with women, right? And I've amassed a certain amount of experience. Women who have had physical trauma. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Women who have had been sexually abused. Some sort of negative sexual history mm-hmm. seem disconnected
yeah.
from mm-hmm. their vagina. Now, it doesn't mean that they don't want sex. Some do, some don't. But there is a hardness, a shell. Some pound you, pound, 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 pound. Some talk to you hard, some refer to sex hard. They don't, the intimacy, as a sex therapist, sex educator, what would you say to the woman who have had sexual trauma in their past, who may relate to what I'm saying, or may have dormant thoughts, things that are controlling the way they behave, that they aren't really paying attention to?
Yeah, it's time to heal from that stuff. You know, no, don't allow the past and the things that happened to you continue to affect how you're responding in the present. And it takes a lot of self-work, mm-hmm. you know, because as therapists or coaches or whatever, we are just guides. We cannot do the healing for you. It's really a choice, and it really takes willingness. So a woman has to completely realize, like, these thoughts and my behaviors are not my own. These are conditions that have come from experiences or things that I've gone through in life. And it's really about going back to that place of innocence within her sexuality where she felt the most innocent and free before that stuff happened to her. And then going in and clearing out that energy and then doing a reset. Because at any time you can reset. And we gotta realize too, like, we are spiritual beings having a physical human experience, and you have dominion, complete dominion over your body. But when you start thinking that you are a body, and you use the physical attacks that were that you experienced through your body as the determining factor for who you are as a being, that's when you start shutting down and stuff like that. But when you can remember that you're not a body and that you are a spiritual being in a body, you realize that there was nothing that could actually really attack you as a being. Because, yeah, this stuff happened to your body, but your spirit is still intact and your spirit is still whole. So on an energetic level, you have to heal. You got to detach yourself from the fact that that you have a body, you're not a body, you have a body, and really make up in your mind that you want to heal from this stuff. Some women, not even just women, men and women, can sometimes be so attached to that thing that happened to them, and they don't know, they don't know what life is beyond what happened to them. And so you continue to use that thing to attack yourself and to hold yourself back, because for some odd reason there is comfort in that distress or that dis-ease. But it takes courage and willingness for a person to move beyond those things that happen to say, you know what? This happened, but it's not affecting me in the present. That's me living in the past. I need to release this stuff.
I feel like men do that so much more.
Yeah, they do. Because guess what? Men are not even given the platform or even the permission to express, right, to grieve, to express their emotions. And then when you do, you're attacked for it. And listen, I advocate for men all the time because I say it on social media constantly. Men need healing too. And I swear to God,
we're weak for that. If we say that, yeah, we're weak.
And you know what? And women need to stop with the shaming.
It's because other men,
women.
Well, other men,
yeah, but women got to realize we are the ones that can start and end anything.
Mm-hmm.
And so as women, we can allow men to be who they naturally are. We have emotions, you know what I mean? They need to be expressed in some kind of way for us to be able to deal with the shit. But women will be like attacking me. Oh, men will be all right. They're good. You don't need to advocate for them. Like, I be getting attacked on Twitter when I'm standing up for men. I'm like, well, goddamn. No wonder men cannot move on and heal, because the women who are the beginning and end of everything aren't even supporting.
Yeah, but I think that's like a hurt people thing. The women that have been hurt and scorned, and they look at men with all this, you know, mouth.
And
now they're like, they'll be all right.
Now, okay.
So that's...
We gotta mention, of course, you know, over history, women have not always been treated the most kind by men. You know, sold as property, viewed as property, viewed as second-rate citizens, all this stuff. But again, that's using the past to attack yourself. And I just think that we need to encourage men to speak up more and to speak out more and to be supportive of that. Because that's the only way you're going to heal. Because when we heal, we're not healed alone. You know, we have to be in relationships and join with other people in order to receive our healing. You can't do that alone by yourself, being a hermit, being an introvert. No. You and like this man says all the time, being in romantic relationships will bring up your shit the fastest to heal.
Mm-hmm.
And this is why so many people get, quote-unquote, burned by love. Because they don't realize that being in a romantic relationship is not a cakewalk. This isn't a vacation. This is still spiritual work. And it's a holy, aka healing, encounter. And your partner is going to reflect back to you the stuff that you need to work on in order to heal. And there is nothing that anyone can ever do or say, unless it's a physical attack, to harm you. Because it's all about your perception. This man could say, I don't like your hair. And if I perceive that as an attack, then I'm using his words to attack myself. But however, like whatever he said wasn't meant to be an attack or whatever. It's how you perceive it.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it's all about your mind. Everything is here. Everything is here. And then the body follows. This is why people have to learn how to be an observer of their ego, because the ego does not want anything good for us. It wants to kill us. It's insidious. It continues to play back that stuff that's happened to us over and over again and being like, see, this is why you can't trust people. Because remember that time that thing happened to you? Yeah, well, this person is following these patterns. And if you continue to go forward, the same thing might happen. And it's like, well, goddamn, can I give this a chance? Can I give this person a fair chance without projecting the ego's illusions onto them?
What are the two keys to a healthy relationship?
Having a common purpose and a common curriculum. A common purpose means, why are we doing this? Why are we here? Where is this going? Curriculum meaning tools to be able to navigate your relationship and tools to ward off the ego when it starts speaking to you. Because look, you see us here, intimate, lovey-dovey, all this, but don't think for 1 minute that we don't have egos too. We're fucking human. We all got that shit. But we choose not to attack each other with what the ego is bringing to us because we have the tools to be observer of our minds and not allow these illusions, because the ego only tells you lies. We don't bring the lies and the stories and shit to each other. We stay rooted in our purpose, which is to love each other, and that's what gets us through. But the average person doesn't have the curriculum and doesn't have a purpose for why they're even in relationships, even sexual ones, and they're using this to hurt themselves.
You have exhibited, you too, as a unit, one, natural love, real, you've given us some gems. And I want to be able to lead my followers and our fans and our listeners back to you. Where will my fans be able to find you?
Oh, yes. Somebody everywhere. I'm on Twitter at GlamazonTyomi. My website, sexperttyomi.com. My blog site, GlamErotica101.com. YouTube.com/GlamErotica101. I'm on Instagram, GlamazonTyomi. Snapchat, GlamazonTyomi. And honestly, if you don't remember any of that, you can just put GlamazonTyomi or Tyomi Morgan into Google, and all the stuff will pop up. Right. It's really not hard to find.
When we first started talking, when I tell you, she started telling me, Glamazon Time, I'm a sex expert. This is my Twitter, Glamazon. This is my Snapchat. Bro, this shit wouldn't stop. Because now I'm trying to be a professional. This is something that I've never really thought about doing. There's a business to everything that you do. Uh-huh. This is a business. And when you spoke to me, it made me realize that you are a fucking, first of all, you're amazing at what you do.
Thank you.
But you take your shit very seriously.
I do.
Because after she, let me just finish
it. Yeah, go ahead.
After you said it, Twitter, Snapchat, Facebook, YouTube.
LinkedIn.
Nick, boy, when I tell you to hold up, I said, well, damn, you sent me your whole mini kit. She said, no, but I do have a mini kit. I was like, no, wait, no, stop. Okay, I get it. You know what you're doing. To those of you who have enjoyed the show, shout out to your YouTube. We have been streaming the show on her YouTube. I very rarely can say that I know I'm in the presence of somebody who really gets it. Who can break a situation down from their experiences, from what the work that they've done, from listening to people, and say, and be able to put all of that together and give you something. She actually is good at what she does.
I appreciate that, because I feel a lot of energy.
And sir, you are as well. You guys are great kissers.
I orgasm a couple of times. Yeah. Like mentally.
If you want to see what we've been doing, we'll be streaming this on YouTube. You can see Ghostface Come Killer. Kiana. Ghostface Killer Come.
K-I on Instagram.
Miss Glamazon Tyomi. Yes. Mr. Naeem. Najib.
Yes.
Thank you all. So shame. Let's go downstairs. We're gonna do that. We're gonna do it in the bedroom. And I'm gonna bring some in the bedroom.
That room is amazing.
You can have some more. My sister made them.
I got some.
My sister. Hi guys. Thanks for watching. Almost forgot you guys were there. No, you didn't miss this round. Well, unless you just logged in, but you can always watch it, after the fact. The first half of this, I don't know if it uploaded or not. I think I sent it to my Dropbox. I will try to upload it if it did. But thank you guys for tuning in. This was a blast.
It really was.
I will be tuning in for more lives, for podcasts that I'm going to be on and all that.
Don't forget
that,
me.
So.
I'm going to tune in too one day.
Shout out to Tahoe.
Thank y'all for listening.
So
Tahoe TV on Instagram.
Tahoe TV on Instagram. We got
K-I on Instagram. K-A-Y-E-Y-E.
Yes. And then my beautiful husband back here.
Now you, not you.
Hey.
So, yeah, we'll see you guys next time. Peace.